the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. And hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me.
Welcome to this Easter celebration. This is a bittersweet day, isn't it? We come together today in our own homes in self-isolation. We mourn the loss of our ability to come together as the family of God to celebrate his glorious resurrection. We mourn the loss to come together with our families and our friends on this traditional day of feasting and celebrating. Some of us are dealing with fear and anxiety as we think about the world that we're living in, as we deal with the uncertainty of the near future. And so we come together with these thoughts on our minds. But we should remember today that we come in the privacy of our own homes and the safety of our own homes to proclaim this truth, to hear these words again, these words that surpass all doubt and abolish all fear. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. May today be a wonderful reminder of this important truth. And may you be ministered to by the Holy Spirit as we worship him today. I invite you to sing along in your homes, to listen as the word is proclaimed, to read along as we proclaim our faith and affirm our faith together today. Let's open our service with this call to worship and this time of prayer. This is the good news. The grave is empty. Christ is risen. This is the good news. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never put it out. This is the good news. Once we were no people, now we are God's people. Christ is our peace, the indestructible peace we now share with each other. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Living God, rejoicing in this day of resurrection, we have come to celebrate the strength of your love, a love that triumphs even over death. As we exult in the miracle of your incarnate love, we thank you for the opportunity to encounter the risen Christ today, wherever we are. In your glorious and victorious name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
on Easter, it is tradition for the church, wherever it's gathered and however it's gathered, to remember what it believes and to affirm its belief in the risen Lord. And so today I invite you to join me in reading the Apostles' Creed from your home as this affirmation of our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Church universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you.
Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated on the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. For if you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God, when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory.
Bled and died for me.
I know these last few weeks have been fairly heavy, and we're dealing with a lot, but I did want to just start off today with a little bit of humor, some lightheartedness, just to get us started on the right foot today. A couple of good Easter dad jokes, and I'll start with this one. Why can't a rabbit's nose be 12 inches long? Because then it would be a foot. I'll just give you a second to compose yourselves after that, and I'll finish with this one. What do you call 10 rabbits marching backwards? A receding hairline. Yes, great dad jokes today, and once you're finished with your uproarious laughter, I would invite you to turn in your Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter 20. We're going to read verses 1 to 18. This wonderful account of the resurrection as recorded by John in his gospel. You know, first words are usually very important. When you think about the first words of a letter, usually they help give us a sense of what the writer wants to talk about, and they say the important things. The salutation is always an important thing. When you think about when you write a report, if you're a student, or when you remember being a student, you think about your opening sentence, and it needs to be something that grabs the attention of the people that are going to read your report. And then you have a thesis statement, which sets the tone for the rest of your report. It includes all of the information that you want to expand upon in the rest of your report. First words are important because you know the old Head & Shoulders commercial is right. You never get a second chance to make a first impression. John's gospel includes a tremendous encounter with Mary and Jesus in the garden as John tells the resurrection story. It's my favorite recalling of the resurrection account, and I think John has some really great things to talk to us about. John isn't just telling a story. He could have just narrated the event in cold third-person narration and given us only the facts. But John is recalling some important conversations containing some vital truths. The first words of post-resurrection Jesus. Important words. Words that set the tone. Words that make an amazing first impression. And so, let us read the story today. And as we do so, listen to the first words of Jesus. Early on Sunday morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. She ran and found Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and she said, "They have taken the Lord's body out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." Peter and the other disciple started out for the tomb. They were both running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He stooped and looked in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he didn't go in. Then Simon Peter arrived and went inside. He also noticed the linen wrappings lying there. And while the cloth that had covered Jesus' head was folded up and lying apart from the other wrappings. Then the disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For until then, they still hadn't understood the scriptures that said Jesus must rise from the dead. Then they went home. Mary was standing outside the tomb crying, and as she wept, she stooped and looked in. She saw two white-robed angels, one sitting on the at the head and the other at the foot of the place where the body of Jesus had been lying. "Dear woman, why are you crying?" the angels asked her. "Because they have taken away my Lord," she replied, "and I don't know where they've put him." She turned to leave and saw someone standing there. It was Jesus, but she didn't recognize him. "Dear woman, why are you crying?" Jesus asked. "Who are you looking for?" She thought he was the gardener. "Sir," she said, "if you have taken him away, tell me where you've put him, and I will go and get him." "Mary," Jesus said. She turned to him and cried out, "Rabboni," which is Hebrew for teacher. "Don't cling to me," Jesus said, "for I haven't yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene found the disciples and told them, "I have seen the Lord." Then she gave them this message. This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is an important scene. It's a scene that includes, as I've already said, these critical first words of Jesus. And while they may seem inconsequential at first glance, they include so much that is important for us to understand and glean this Easter Sunday. It happens in a garden. Have you ever noticed that? I'm sure you have. But perhaps again this morning, let's consider this. This scene happens in a garden, and it's not coincidental in John's view. John sees great significance in a garden scene where relationships are renewed. Did you notice the first word that Jesus speaks? "Woman, who are you looking for?" Jesus, the Creator, comes to Mary and calls her woman, a name given in the garden. the Garden of Eden, by the Creator, Jesus himself. And in so doing, Jesus reveals that the enmity, the separation created in the garden, has been abolished. Jesus and many scholars and many traditions think that this is a way for John to do a full circle and return to the Garden of Eden and show that the relationship that was broken is now being restored between God and his creation. It's a wonderful opening phrase. Woman, who are you looking for? Mary is looking for the body of Jesus, not understanding that he stands in front of her now. This part of the scene is also highly evocative of the garden in Genesis. Think about it. In Genesis, we see God the Father walking in the garden, searching for his people, looking for and longing for the relationship for which they had been created. The scene comes to a head when he discovers that his people are hiding from him in shame. A barrier has been raised through their disobedience, making this relationship that he seeks, that he desires, unavailable. This scene sees the journey having come full circle. God the Son walks in the garden and finds that his people are looking for him, and now the barrier that existed between God and his people and relationship has been removed through the death of Jesus on the cross. The resurrected Jesus is now fully able to enter into a relationship with his creation. These are important words. They signal the removal of the barrier and the renewal of relationship. These words are, in some ways, ironic. Mary thinks that she is searching for Jesus, but actually Jesus has found her and made available to her new life. This scene is a wonderful illustration of God's dogged pursuit of his people come to fruition. You see, the moment in the garden when that relationship is severed and that barrier goes up, the whole theme of Scripture, one of the overarching, if not the overarching theme of Scripture, is God's work to restore what has been broken, to bring justice to the injustice of the world, to bring about relationship where it was not possible. And so we see here the full realization, the full pursuit of God, God's pursuit of his people come to fruition. Do you realize as you read the resurrection story that God has brought to completion his work of restoring his relationship and the ability to know his creation? And do you consider this wonderful truth that John embeds in this story? Jesus seeks out Mary, although she thinks she's the one searching for Jesus. Jesus seeks her out in this final act of realizing this renewed relationship and its possibility. Jesus seeks her out. Do you realize in this resurrection story, as you read it today and hear it today, that God has searched for you and has made it possible for you to know him? This is the climax of his great work. This is the reason that he has gone to the cross. This is what he has set out to do. The scene continues. Jesus' next word is to call Mary by name. John has Jesus call out Mary. Yes, first he says woman, but now he calls her by her own name. Indeed, this reveals the nature of the relationship. In calling Mary by name, Jesus is affirming that the relationship between God and his people is personal. He is not aloof. He does not call to his people from far off. He's not uninvolved. He knows about his people. He cares for his people. He knows his people intimately. And so it is significant that he calls Mary by her name. Today, on Easter Sunday, if you're feeling a sense of isolation, a sense of loneliness, a sense of disconnect? Be reminded, the risen Lord knows you by name, and he calls out to his people by name. John includes this on purpose, that you and I who read this and hear this would recognize that this is the pattern of our risen Lord, to call his people by name. The risen Lord knows us, is intimately aware of us. He knows our circumstances. As we have thought about on Good Friday, he is intimately acquainted with suffering and relates to us in that aspect as well. But he knows where we're at. He finds us and he calls us by name. He stands ready to help, ready to be involved. Now, that is a glorious conversation. And if that was all that was involved in this conversation, it would be glorious enough. But there's more. This is a two-way conversation. John wants us to think about more than just the resurrected Jesus knowing his people. It's about more than God just loves me. All through John's gospel, there's this thread that runs through it. Those who Jesus knows also know him. Now, that seems like a redundant statement that I'm making, and I make a lot of redundant statements. I know that. But this is significant. It's not a one-sided activity here. God knows his people, and his people, his true followers, know him. John wants those who hear this message today to think back to Jesus' words. In the man born blind and in the raising of Lazarus, Jesus calls them and they hear and follow. Remember? The man born blind doesn't see Jesus with his eyes because, of course, he's blind. Jesus calls to him and commands him and gives him instruction, and the blind man hears and follows those instructions before ever seeing Jesus. Lazarus is dead in the grave. And it isn't until Jesus calls out his name that Lazarus hears and responds and walks out alive and free. In the explanation of the healing of the man born blind, Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd." And he goes into a great explanation about the workings of shepherd and sheep. And basically, Jesus, we could summarize this partly by saying, when his sheep hear his voice, they come to him. When the good shepherd's sheep hear the shepherd calling to them, they hear and recognize and follow. John reminds us that those who know Jesus recognize his voice and come to him. This isn't the only time, and not the last time, in Jesus' resurrection appearances where those who follow him won't recognize him until he speaks familiar words to them. There's something significant in these words. This is a gospel of discipleship. And this is a scene about what it means to be a disciple. Mary is a disciple of Jesus. And when he speaks her name, yes, it signifies this personal relationship, but she recognizes who he is, because she is his follower. We understand that Mary follows the voice of the Good Shepherd, and she is prepared to follow him and go with him. The Easter story is not just a good news story to make you and me feel nice. It's a reminder that we serve a risen Lord who calls out to his people, and he calls out to his people that he knows intimately so that they will recognize his voice and follow him where he leads and calls. Where is he asking Mary to follow? Well, we'll get there today and in the weeks to come. But for now, let's consider this. Her personal encounter with Jesus, who sought her out and who called her by name, invites her to respond by embracing the renewed life, the abundant resurrection life that Jesus embodies and now calls her to participate in. Jesus calls his followers to participate in life with him. What a wonderful concept to consider this Easter Sunday. And this brings us to our next phrase. Jesus says, "Don't cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father." Now, I've always thought this was a strange phrase. Now, I'm a bit of a sci-fi fan, and so this part of the gospel story always strikes me as interesting, and I'm always drawn to it because Jesus likes to appear like in locked rooms all of a sudden, and he's kind of depicted in his resurrection appearances in all the gospels as somehow, you know, all of a sudden being with his disciples as they're walking along the road, or he's giving them directions to do some miraculous things. And there's just this supernatural aspect of the resurrected Jesus. Yes, he's a renewed, he has a physical body that we believe this wholeheartedly, but there's something different about it as well in his resurrection appearance. And I've always thought that this was a strange phrase. Is there something about Jesus' renewed body that prevents him from being touched? Is Jesus somehow all of a sudden become apart from his creation in a way that they can't understand? Well, I think the rest of the phrase gives us an insight here. "I have not yet ascended to the Father." A curious phrase. You see, we know that eventually Jesus does ascend. But why say it here to Mary, who is obviously overjoyed at seeing Jesus and wants to embrace her beloved teacher? He's not aloof. We've already kind of gone over that. He's not standing there with his arms at his side and afraid to be touched. What is going on here? Why does John have this conversation included? Why does Jesus speak these words? Well, perhaps there's a sense here that there is more to be experienced. And Jesus is well aware of this, as is John. Jesus is not being distant and asking Mary not to cling to him. Perhaps he is reminding her of the more that he envisions. Jesus has an abundant life envisioned for his people. Remember, in John 10, Jesus says, "I have come that you may have life and have it abundantly." Jesus says in the account of the raising of Lazarus that he is the resurrection and the life. Jesus has a resurrection life envisioned for his people, a life of freedom from sin, a life lived in the certain hope and knowledge of the defeat of death, a life lived in relationship and discipleship. It is a renewed life, and it is a life that is actually enabled and empowered by the Holy Spirit. Yes, you see, if Mary clings to the risen Jesus, how will she be able to embrace what is to come? It's natural. It's natural for us to want to embrace what we see in front of us. We are people who are creatures who shy away from change. We are people who want to stay where we are. Peter says to Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration, "Let's stay here for a while, Lord, and I'll make you a tabernacle so that you and Moses and Elijah can stay here." But Jesus always envisions more and calls them to experience more. Yes, if Mary clings to the risen Jesus, how will she embrace what is to come? As nice as it would be for her to stay and embrace him, she must let him go so that the counselor, the companion that Jesus speaks of in John chapter 14 can come for all of Jesus' people, for you and for me today. He knew there was more to experience. This Easter, who or what are we clinging to? That's a good question to ask. Are we clinging to a sense of security? Are we clinging to an idea of what it means to live for Jesus? What do we have to let go of in order to experience what Jesus has in store? For he has something more in store for us than what we've already experienced. He keeps calling us further and further in to this life, this resurrection life that he has offered to us. What are we clinging to? Is it pride? Is it a sense of safety and security, of comfort? What are we clinging to that is keeping us from journeying further to what Jesus has in store? Let's move on to the next phrase. Jesus immediately has Mary go and do something. He says, "Now go and tell my brothers, I am ascending to my Father and their Father, to my God and their God." He immediately has her go tell the rest of the disciples what she has seen and what has happened. "I am ascending to my Father and their Father, my God and their God." What is this? What is this phrase? I think John wants us to read this phrase and hear this phrase, and I think Jesus says this phrase for his disciples so that they would understand that they are also included. This is a phrase of inclusion. Inclusion in relationship. Now, the relationship between the Father and Son has been made available through the death and resurrection, through the ascending and the sending of the Spirit to the followers of Jesus. It's no longer reserved for him and the Father, but my Father and their Father, my God and their God. This is what Jesus has accomplished and now invites his followers to enter into, this intimate relationship. This is a statement that reminds us that this is for everyone. This is for you and for me, and we are included in what God has for us, or what Jesus has accomplished. We're included in this relationship that he has enjoyed with the Father. A renewed resurrection life, a renewed resurrection relationship. And Mary isn't just a messenger. A messenger, yes, but she is given this task. And so by being given the task by Jesus, she is also included. It's not just for those, that group of men huddled together in a room wondering what's going on. This is for her to participate in as well. Jesus is validating her as a person already, but also as a disciple with a job, with a mission, with a purpose. This message is for all, Mary and the disciples. This is not a fact that would be lost on the first readers or hearers of this gospel message, and this is not a fact that should be lost on you and me today. She is the one who receives the message directly from Jesus, and she is the messenger. The inclusion is for her and for everybody, and the inclusion isn't just in relationship, but it is an inclusion in mission and purpose as well. Isn't that amazing? Jesus invites his people to not only hear his voice, but to follow his voice and join in the new life and the mission of the new life, announcing the renewal and relationship that is offered to all. This Easter, may we be encouraged. May we rejoice as we remember that we are included in this relationship. But may we also remember that we are invited and included as participants in the mission of Jesus as we follow him and listen to his voice every day. First, words are significant, aren't they? And these are no different. These are words of renewal, of relationship, of discipleship, of inclusion, of invitation, and of mission. And just remember, these just aren't first words, but in many ways, these are last words, at least the beginnings of the last words. And as we know from every movie we've ever watched where the hero comes to an end in the story, the last words that the hero gives are the most important words, right? Arnold Schwarzenegger sums it all up when he says, "I'll be back." And certainly, this is the kind of weight that hangs on these words, exponentially so. Yes, these words are doubly important because they are the first and the last words spoken by the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. And these words spoken by the Alpha and Omega, the resurrected Jesus in the garden, are spoken not only to Mary and not only to those first disciples, but they are spoken to you and to me collectively each day as he renews us and continually invites us to live in relationship and resurrection life with him. May the first words of Jesus and the beginnings of the last words of Jesus ring in our ears this Easter day and this entire Easter season as we marvel at what he has accomplished and what he has invited us into. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. As we bring our service to conclusion, I want to offer some thanks to Rochelle on the piano, Caleb on the drums, Salix and Chris on the bass, George on the guitar, and Alicia on the sound. Thank you for your service and helping us as we have entered into worship today. I want to continue to encourage our church family to care for one another, to seek ways in which you can be supportive to each other in these difficult times, to continue to see ways that you can be the messengers of God's resurrection message and his renewal in the world that we're living in. And I commend you for what you have already been doing and continue to encourage you to not give up and to continue to in your work as Christ's ambassadors in our community. I want to also remind you again that you can continue to give here at the church. You can drop by your tithes to the church office. You can e-transfer your tithes to our treasurer at hmnazchurch@gmail.com. And we are reminded again that this is another opportunity for us to worship God, to acknowledge his provision in our lives, and to acknowledge our reliance upon him. As we close this service today, please remember also that if you have a need, if you have a prayer request, if you have a way in which your church family can assist you, please reach out, call the church office, send us an email, and we would love to be able and available during these days to help our church family and support you in any way we can. Hear these words of benediction as we close this Easter Sunday service. As Christ burst forth from the tomb, may new life burst forth from us and show itself in acts of love and healing to a hurting world. And may the same Christ who lives forever and is the source of our new life keep your hearts rejoicing and grant you peace this day and always. Amen.